Good morning. Welcome to Grace United Methodist Church. We are glad that you are here. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And I just wanted to ask us a question as we come together this morning. When you came into this place today, what did you expect to happen? When you came, when you pulled up to 145 Grace Drive, what did you expect to happen? I hope and pray you expected to have a relationship, a connection, to meet God in this place. I hope that that's what you expect, because that's why we come together every week. That's the why behind the what we do. We come together to meet God in this place, to be equipped as God's people, to go out those doors in about an hour and make a difference in this world in which we live. So I am glad that you are here, excited that you are here this morning. Hopefully you received an order of worship when you came in the door. A few things I would like to point out to you inside your order of worship. I'm not going to read everything to you. I hope that you will take the time to do that so that you know what's going on in the life of the church. But there are some things that I would like to point out. One of the very first things is today, immediately following church, don't forget the New Beginning soup sale if you've already purchased your ticket. Also, you will see there in the calendar for the week the planned financial workshop. Well, some bad news there. Miss Jennifer Irwin is sick. She texted me last night and said she hopes she would feel better today, but she is still very, very sick. So that will be put off. We will hopefully have a later time for that. But so the workshop will not be happening today after worship. Also, inside your order of worship, take note of the upcoming sermon series. We finish up a sermon series today, and we begin another one next week. And it is a focus from the Sermon on the Mount. And so I hope that you will take some time for the next few Sundays as we come together to learn from the Sermon on the Mount. Next Sunday, 10:30 a.m. to 11 a.m., In His Steps Appreciation Breakfast. You think, what's that about? Well, here's the deal. Everything that happens in here, Sunday morning, Wednesday night, throughout the week, it happens because people have signed up to help serve in the church, to volunteer in the church, to make things happen in the church. And so next Sunday from 10:30 to 11, we just want to say thank you. And so we just want to do that to show you we appreciate you. So please make sure you are a part of that next Sunday morning from 10:30 to 11. Please take note of the upcoming information about February. We're going to begin to offer some alternate ways of giving in the church. One thing we've noticed is a lot of folks, especially younger generations, do not carry checks anymore. In fact, we had a conversation in the finance meeting, and one lady said, I've never even written a check. And we said, what? And she said, yeah, it's just not part of my generation. And we said, okay. And a lot of folks, just alternate ways of giving. So just keep that in the back of your mind. You'll be hearing more information there. And then one final thing inside your order of worship, you'll see a note in the calendar for the week section about special prayer time. Every Sunday after worship, there's a time for special prayer in the prayer room. And I hope that you would take advantage of that if you find yourself in the need of prayer. And I would suggest to us that every one of us at some point in time are in need of prayer. You also notice there's a prayer hotline. You ever heard that old gospel song, Jesus on the Main Line? Well, this might not be Jesus on the main line, but it's the prayer team on the main line, and they connect with Jesus pretty quickly. And so if there's a prayer concern, please remember that number. Plug it in your phone as a contact. That's what I've done. You just plug it in, put Grace Prayer Chain. If there's a prayer concern, you send that a text or a phone call, and the prayer team gets on it like that. And just one word about the prayer team. You going to say something? Or?
Yeah.
Oh, well, okay. Go ahead. Yeah, that's your cue. I didn't know you was going to say something, but that's your cue. It works.
Thank you. We have cards. We have business cards. They're not for the prayer team, but it's a prayer hotline. And when Jason asked a couple of weeks ago, who needs prayer, everybody's hand went up. I think there was hardly anybody in here that didn't raise your hand. So, but there are people out there, and truthfully, we get more requests from outside of this church for prayer than we do inside. So, yeah, it's fabulous, but we know just from the circumstances that go on in our own lives, that, you know, this can't be something that where you don't need prayer because you've already said you did. So.
Jennifer wants some now.
Yeah. All right, so we have prayer cards. If you have a business or you run into a lot of people out there, maybe you can't put the, you know, the business card out there on the table, but maybe you can keep them in your wallet or in your purse, and when someone comes up and says, man, I need some prayer today, and, you know, you say, oh, I've got just what you need, and you get out this prayer card, and it has our number on it. If they're really shy, we don't answer the phone, but the person, we have a message, and the person can leave the message. If they need a call back, we will call them immediately. So you don't have to worry about, you know, nobody answering or whatever, because it will be answered, and they will be prayed for on that day. So you just keep that in mind. I'm going to stand out here in the narthex where you come out, and I have a lot of these. If you want to put some, you know, in your purse, carry them around or whatever, just stop and get some, because we have about 500. So everybody here should be able to get one, or a lot.
Thank you, MJ. And just one testimony, and I'm not going to take too much time, hopefully. Most of you know Stephen was in an accident last Sunday, and very fortunate to be alive and very fortunate to be here with no brain or spinal injury. But when found out, you know, got to have surgery, got to the hospital, I shot MJ a text and said, be praying. And she and the prayer team got on and prayed. Monday night, he couldn't stand and he couldn't walk. And I sent MJ a text and said, we need some special prayer for this boy's hip, because he can't walk and he can't stand. We don't know what kind of damage there is, but we need some special prayer. And the prayer team, along with many others, but the prayer team especially, they started, best way I know how to tell you, they started bombarding heaven with prayers for my boy. Tuesday morning, I got back to the hospital about 6:30. Amber woke up. I said, well, how was Stephen's night last night? She said, you ain't going to believe it. She said, last night he was actually able to get up by himself to go to the restroom. And Tuesday morning, he was able to walk. So tell me the Lord don't hear your prayer. Tell me, I'm trying not to start preaching right now, but tell me we don't have a God who sees what we need and provides exactly what we need when we need it. He may not always give us what we want, but he always gives us exactly what we need. We have a God who hears our prayers, church. Don't ever think you have a God who don't hear you. Pray to God about everything and trust him with everything, because God is working even when we can't see it. Stand with me this morning. Let's remind ourselves the very basics, the fundamentals, the foundations of the Christian faith, that when we say we are Christian, this is what makes us Christian. This is what we say we believe. We don't just suppose, we don't just assume, we believe. This is what makes us Christian. Let us join together this morning with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead, even the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And hopefully you've already begun your worship this morning, but we're going to begin it in song right now. So we ask that you remain standing with us.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful day. Lord, help be with the new administration that's taken over, ruling this world. Be behind him. Make him ask you for guidance before he does anything. Be with us, those who are lost, who are lonely. Lord, you know who they are. They need your help. So do we. And be with us as we say the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I want to ask Eric Daly, Bill Cheek, you guys, go ahead and come up. In your order of worship, you'll see something that says commercial break, because you watch TV it's about the time that a commercial would come on right now. I asked these gentlemen to share briefly just a word about Sunday school, to remind us of the importance of Sunday school. So if y'all will, grab a mic and share, please.
This morning I was amped up over having to speak to y'all because I'm relatively new to Sunday school, okay? I try, but I've got a ways to go, so hopefully my exuberance will outweigh my ignorance. Somebody special here gave me a devotional, and today's message was, anything that tends to make you anxious is a growth opportunity. Trust me, I'm anxious right now. Instead of running away from these challenges, embrace them. Eager to gain all the blessings I have hidden in the difficulties. So I'm going to try to do that. There are many in this room today who have been part of something larger than themselves. They are coaches, teachers, nurses, mothers and fathers, grandparents, aunts and uncles, and good neighbors, caregivers, supervisors, managers, and business leaders. People in this room have been guides and teachers to others who didn't understand or who hadn't honed their skills. People in this room made a difference with someone struggling with something just out of their reach. For instance, the student who just doesn't quite understand algebra despite hours of study. The football player who is not All-American but picks himself up time and again to execute the play according to plan. So the athlete approaches the coach and asks for extra help. He wants to do it right. The math student asks her teacher for some extra time after class to go over the lessons. She is frustrated. She wants to get it right. Many of you have been approached by folks like these, and they want to learn and they want to do better. And you, God bless you, took the time out of your schedule and mentored them. You gave them guidance, and you encouraged them, and you gave them insight and perspective and faith in themselves. You were caregivers in the quest for understanding. And what happened? In the process, you came to care for them and wish for them the best with their God-given talents. And for many, many of you helpers, you were blessed and connected in ways that you could never have been otherwise. Perhaps this is the fingerprint of God on us. We help those who seek it. They strive for something better. And together we see in our brothers and sisters achievement and hope and faith in that connection. There is a bond. In Sunday school, we go in knowing we need help. time in the Word. The Bible covers a lot of turf. We have questions. We can't recite dozens of passages off the top of our heads. Much of the teachings can be difficult to grasp. Yet into this space, we go and we open in prayer for those sick and with needs. And in so doing, we invite God to be with us. We invite our God who made us and knows what is best for us to help teach us. Under Jim Rohn's gentle touch, the lessons begin. Life experiences are put in context. Scripture is exposed, and our faces light up with new understanding. In those sessions, God reveals himself and honors the efforts of those in Sunday school who try and make more sense of God and his plan and where they fit in. And a miracle occurs, just like the football player or the math student. We are mentored and encouraged, and there is new awareness and perspective. There is a bond. We are better connected to God. All too soon, we close in prayer, and we ask God to bless again the sick and the needy. We ask God to bless our upcoming church service in Jason, and we thank God for what he has just done. Give me just a second. I'm struggling. Forgive me. Andy Stanley says this about practical teaching, and he has taught many. When people talk about their spiritual journeys, a typical comment from them revolves around their initial exposure to someone who taught the Bible in a practical, life-impacting way. They will say, "For the first time, I understood what the Bible means, and I understood what I was supposed to do." They began to actually apply Scripture to their lives, to their families, to their finances, to their work, their morality, and their ethics, and suddenly God came alive to them as never before. This isn't going to go on forever. They'll often say, "I believe this stuff all my life, but I didn't know how to apply it. Once I started doing it, I could begin to see God at work in my life." Andy says again, "What makes the difference in our lives is not simply gaining biblical knowledge, but being exposed to teaching that makes the Bible meaningful, practical, and applicable to everyday life. And then, as Christians, as Jesus followers, responding with action." He also states, "Two things make relationships providential. When we hear from God through someone, and we see God in someone." Let me expose a little bit more about Sunday school and the takeaway from the first section is our connection to God and to our fellow Sunday school classmates. The takeaway from the second part is think about life school. It's not traditional Sunday school, it's life school. Just try to keep that in the back of your mind as I prattle on here. Life is complex. There are hardships and challenges. God meets each of us and knows what we need to perform well. The Bible is our owner's manual. New cars and trucks come with owner's manuals. Where did they get that idea from? Because the automakers know that what those complex vehicles need to perform well. In life and autos, more understanding about design and limits and capabilities will ensure a better and fulfilling journey. Sunday school, as a term, may evoke a certain image. Perhaps you have a vision of someone reading chapter after chapter of short sentences about strange names in strange places and who begat who. Perhaps you think of having to memorize all the names of the books of the Bible in order. Perhaps large portions of the Bible seem to be far from our struggles for career advancement and family dynamics and our finances and our spare time. These views are understandable if Sunday school has not been marketed to show its current content and capabilities. It is my opinion that God is revealing himself more now than ever before. The volume of high-quality teaching material for Sunday school is significant and growing. Here's a snippet of what today's Sunday school focuses on. I need to get a new job. Ever since the new owners have taken over, it seems like everyone is for themselves. I had an expectation that this would be done by the time I got home, and yet again, it's not. What am I to do? I've got $35,000 in this new car, and I'm no happier now than I was before. And now I've got a $450 car payment. What was I thinking? Ever since our daughter had her second child, she is always stressed and her family is struggling. I am so worried. Why is there always more months at the end of the money? This is getting really old. They want me to complete the forms at the office, but this data they provided is just plain wrong. I am not comfortable, but they aren't going away. Folks keep talking about giving to the needy. What does that have to do with me? We're making more money than ever, but our savings is less than it was last year. How did that happen? I'm visiting this website about 15 times a day, and I'm not getting anything done. That project is due soon, and I am worried to death. When I helped out with that project over on the other side of town, I felt so much better. How do I bottle that magic for future use? My doctor says that Joey is going to need surgery, and he won't be able to participate in his favorite sport ever again. He's going to be devastated. I don't have time to get anything done anymore, and now they're saying I need to set aside time to pray. What? Today's Sunday school is a serious Christian expertise. It is being networked and reworked and edited and improved. Humor and real-life experience on full display. God is leveraging all of this to get us closer to him. Jason is well aware of these materials, and he recommends much of this to our Sunday school classes. Anybody who's been around a while knows the saying, "If I had known back then what I know now." If you go to Sunday school, you will know now instead of then. God already knows what we should be prepared for and how we can call on him for help. It's in the manual, the Bible, and we will be more capable, more resilient to hardship and failure, avoid sin, and we can be a resource to others. As I close, please consider this. Visualize a vast, beautiful landscape filled with Christians from all walks of life coming together. There's a group hug, and each tells a story of how they were drawn closer to God because of a kind word, because of a considerate kick in the butt, because of a helping hand with a ramp for a sick relative. Sorry. Because of a weekly jar of peanut butter and a weekly lunch for a hungry youngster. Pray for me. Someone gave marriage another try and they made it. A career was put on hold to spend more time with the kids. Less web surfing, more conversation at the dinner table led to joy. 15 minutes each morning in writing a prayer journal. And thanks for living in the United States because you know you've already won life's lottery. Someone who found support and hope because of grace's assistance. All these blessings because of compassion, kindness, humility, generosity, patience, and forgiveness that was nurtured in Sunday school. This is what God wants for us. God bless you every day.
Yeah. I should have went first. Good job, Eric. Harry Powell Sunday School class. We're a men's class. Some would say we're the old men's class. That's okay, too. We meet last room on the left on the adult wing. Start at 9:45. Get there a little bit early. The conversation's usually pretty entertaining before we get started. Kind of like Eric said, where I wanted to go beyond what and when is Sunday school. It's something that's bigger than me. It's bigger than you. It's grace. I got a couple of different analogies, and since we're where we are, we always talk Abbeville football, right? Well, 1977, I had the chance to go over there, and I didn't know what I was doing. Found me a role model. Found somebody I could watch, somebody I could look up to and figure out how he did it. Luckily, it was Dick Williams. Learned a lot about football and life. 1981, we got to put our number on that scoreboard, and now we're part of something bigger. There's been many more put up there since. Sue and I moved back to Abbeville, walked in grace, ran into three gentlemen that reminded me of my grandfather from my grandfather's age. I wish I had Mr. Bill Nichols' smile. I wish I had Mr. Jim Ferguson's tenacity. And I wish I had Mr. Marion McLean's just cool. That man could wear a suit and rock it. I mean, he was the coolest man I knew at the time. Role models, what did they do? They did things that I wanted to do. The first thing I discovered they did, they were part of the men's United Methodist Men. I joined the United Methodist Men. Come to find out, that's a group of men that raise a lot of money for the church. Been cooking hash twice a year from what I've been told, as many years as you can think back. And I can't stand up here and tell you I enjoy every minute of cooking hash. But I can tell you that many minutes cooking hash, I'm looking around saying, yeah, I'm part of something here. This is cool. I like this. It's a good thing. When we were moving from our South Main location, Mike Manley asked me to help him pack some stuff up from our Sunday school class. What we were packing up was the attendance roll from the 40s and the 50s and the 60s and the 70s and the 80s. We also took a couple photographs off the wall. One photograph was of Mr. Harry Powell, and the caption underneath it never met Mr. Powell. But the caption underneath read, led to Sunday school class from the 40s to the 70s. That's not a man you can look up to. I don't know who is. Another picture there had a list of the class from 1989. Y'all may know some of these names. Mr. Asa Griffin, Corey Argo, Albert Martin, Archie Simpson, George Argo, Ray Newell, Hugh Burns, Lee Waltrip, Joe Bruce, Rob Cox. Anybody know any of those people? I'm just guessing here, but I would guess you remember those men as strong Christian men who would do anything in the world for you. They were members of a Sunday school class. They needed support. They needed a group around them so they could be that person. Could I get my brothers from Sunday school class to stand up for me? This group of men is looking to be the same thing. We work every week. Thank you, guys. Y'all can sit down. I appreciate it. I didn't know if they'd stand up or not. We work every day, every Sunday, to try to be better Christians, just like those men. And I don't know about you, but I think it's very, very cool that in whatever building Grace has been in for 80-plus years, there's been a men's Sunday school class turning out that kind of man. Who wouldn't want to be that kind of man? In closing, if you don't have a Sunday school class, come try us. Age does not matter. That does matter. I can promise you that you won't be asked to pray You won't be asked to read the scripture. You won't even have to offer your opinion, but it won't be long you'll be offering your opinion. Thank you.
Bill, Eric, thank you so much for sharing. Thank you for sharing from your heart. Thank you for reminding us the importance of what it is to be connected, connected to God, connected to each other. That's what makes a life meaningful. Let's take a moment, stand up, stretch. Children are dismissed from Children's Church, and greet those around you. Welcome them to Grace. may be seated. Let us take the time now to continue worshiping God with God's tithe and our offering as we have a chance to give back to God a portion of what is God's with God's tithe, to go beyond that tithe, to give an offering, and to know that in all we give and all that is received in this place today helps to further the name of Jesus Christ, helps to bring people to the knowledge and the understanding of God's love and grace for them. So let us pray together this morning. Almighty God, every good and perfect gift comes from You. Almighty God, everything that we claim is our own, You have given it to us and allowed us to have it. And Lord God, when you get down to the nitty-gritty of things, when we think about it, none of us woke ourselves up this morning. Lord God, You woke us up. Lord God, it's You who puts air in our lungs. It is You who brings the beat to a heart. It is You, Lord God, who gives. We are made in Your image. We are called to give. May we give back to You for the work of Your church. May Your Holy Spirit bless and multiply the giving and the receiving in this place today. Amen.
This song that I'm going to be sharing with you was based on a story. It was actually my story in Africa. I belonged to a little church in Africa, and after the service, the band packed up. And this little girl, she was about 7 or 8, every Sunday she'd come to church. And the area that the church was in was a pretty suspect. There was a lot of prostitution, a lot of drugs. And this little kid came every Sunday. And after church, she came to me and she put her hand out. And I said, "Now, my girl, what's that all about?" And she said, "I want to pay." And she opened her hand and she had a penny. So this was her collection. So I took her through and she went and paid this. Anyway, that song always stayed in my, that vision stayed in my mind. Then when I moved to the States, because of that vision, I wrote this song. It's called "I've Only a Penny, Lord." It makes you think. I've asked the guys up there just to put the lyrics up because the lyrics are very, very important to the song. If there's more to God's stuff, but will my penny be enough? I don't have much to offer You. My life's just not shaping up. Lost so much, it's been so tough. I love well, my back's strong, I'll tend the frail. It's really all I can give. I've only a penny, Lord. Is it enough? I look around and question if there's more to God's stuff. But will my penny They say that You heal the sick and You love the meek. Don't know if it's me You seek. I know I really need a friend that will stay with me to the end. Will You be that friend to me? I've only a penny, Lord. Is it enough? I look around and question if there's more to God's stuff. But will my penny
Thank you, Diane. Thank you for sharing that with us. And now we'll just ask that you stand as we present God's tithes and our offerings.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You can be seated.
Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust consumes and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Give. We give of ourselves, of our time, of our money, and all sorts of things. Some things we give ourselves to aren't really that great of an investment. Some things we give ourselves to, we give ourselves too much to that and not enough to God. I've noticed this past, and I'm not going to get political, so that's safe, but I've just noticed this past political season. People will give themselves to a Democratic Party way too much. People will forget that their Savior is not in a White House. He's on a throne, and He's coming back. I noticed Friday at the inauguration, people will give themselves all kinds of things, whether good or bad. I noticed yesterday that people will go stand in a pouring rain to protest women's rights. Not that I'm against women's rights, I'm just saying. But let's move from the political scene. I noticed that when some people who like to wear orange and purple will declare they are all in, they will give themselves to that team wholeheartedly. I've also noticed that people of other preference of teams will give themselves wholeheartedly. And not only of themselves, but of their money and of their time. And just kind of thinking about that, I've noticed that when it is football season, I don't know about other teams because I've never participated a whole lot in those other teams. But I do notice that when Clemson's playing at home, especially at home, people will spend all week preparing and thinking about what that tailgate's going to look like. They will make all the phone calls necessary. They will have the menu planned out. They will know who's bringing what. They will have who's bringing the plates, who's bringing the cups, who's got the tents, who's got all this, that, the other, who's providing breakfast, because you know even if you play at 8 o'clock at night, you've got to get there at 6:30 in the morning, and you've got to have pancakes for breakfast, then you've got to have something for lunch, then you've got to go have something for dinner, and if they play earlier, then you've got to go into the game, then you've got to come back and cook after the game, because we give ourselves to all kinds of things. Was it some 80,000 people gave themselves? And if you went, I'm not knocking you, I'm just saying. But they gave themselves to go sit in a stand and watch that game again? And to stand in a parade? 70,000? Okay, 70,000. I rounded up. And again, that's okay if you want to do that. I'm not knocking you. But all I also know is when it comes to getting to church on Sunday morning, we have a hard time getting here. When it comes to getting here on time, we have a hard time getting here. When it comes to giving ourselves to a Sunday school class, as you've already heard about it, we have a hard time getting here. We can make sure we're at where we want to be any other time. I'm not trying to beat us up this morning. I just want us to begin thinking about what do we give ourselves to? What are you giving yourself to? Is it worth all of that? Because here's what I've also come to realize in my short 36 years of life. Everybody has priorities. What are your priorities? In terms of priorities, here's what I've also learned. If it matters to you, you will make it happen. If it doesn't matter to you, you will make excuses. At this point, I could drop mic, walk off stage, but I ain't done yet. Because in terms of the church and giving yourself wholeheartedly to what God has called you to, in terms of giving your entire self to God, because in this series we've been talking about money. We've talked about making all you can, saving all you can, and today giving all you can. But what I want you to hear from me this morning, in this idea of giving all you can, this is not just about your money. It is about your money, but not just your money. How are you giving all that you are to the Creator of the universe and the one who died on the cross for you? How are you giving all that you are to God? And you do that, you begin doing that in the life of the church. And here's something I've also understood about us in the life of the church. From the pulpit all the way back, there's a big difference between being compliant and being committed. Compliant means I will do enough just to get by. Committed means I will do whatever it takes. Where do you fall into that category? Because God has called us to give. And God challenges us to give. God challenges us in the Old Testament book of Malachi to give. God says, test me. Bring your tithe to the storehouse and watch what I do. You see, when you read the New Testament, Jesus never really talked a whole lot about tithing. Jesus talked about sacrificial giving. We want to fuss about the tithe. We don't really want to hear what Jesus has to say about giving, because Jesus says, if you haven't missed it, you really haven't given. I'm reminded of a story in the Gospels of Jesus and what's been called the widow's mite. When Jesus and his disciples are in the temple worshiping, there's all these people bringing large amounts of money. But there's this widow. And Jesus looks and he sees this widow going to give. And he points her out, he gets the attention of his disciples, he says, look at this. She's given all that she has. And she's given more than any other person in here. Because she just didn't give of her wallet, she gave of herself. Or I think about a little young lady here at the church. I referenced her a few weeks ago. New Year's Day, she brought 4 pennies. She gave them to Mr. Reggie. And said, this is all I got. But I'm going to give it to the church. And today, that same little precious girl came up to me before worship. She brought me 3 pennies. She said, that's what I got. I'll be at children's church and y'all take up the money. Will you take this from me? Yes, ma'am. It's giving all that you can. Or I remember a story my dad told me a while back. He was talking about, this is a true story, by the way. He was thinking about, talking about how people need to trust God in giving financially to the church. He remembered one of his old preachers. He was, when my dad was a young Christian, the preacher's name was Reverend Moore. Reverend Moore had been preaching on tithing and giving. And there was a man in the church who heard it, and he said, I'm going to start trying this. So he began to tithe. And again, that passage from Malachi, God says, test me, see what I would do. Bring your tithe to the storehouse while I open up heaven for you. So he began to tithe, and his income became more and more. Because God's math does not make sense, by the way. He began to make more money, which in turn meant he needed to tithe more. Which in turn meant he needed to make more money. He came back to Preacher Moore and he said, Preacher, I took you up on this tithing thing. But I'm having to tithe more and more because the Lord just keeps blessing me. He said, I'm making more money, which means I have to tithe more. He said, this is getting expensive. And Preacher Moore said, I understand that, brother. God's math does not make sense. I tell you what, let's go pray about this. Let's see what God's got to say. So Preacher Moore and this man go to the altar. They pray together. And Preacher Moore begins praying. He says, Lord, you know my brother's heart. He feels like he's tithing way more than he needs to tithe, Lord. So I'm praying that you will help him not make as much money. And the fellow said, whoa, 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 preacher. I'll keep tithing when I'm tithing. That's a true story. That's not made up. Or I remember what I saw this morning. I told Diane she would hear it again in a few hours. Diane had something on Facebook. Sometimes there are good things on Facebook. And Diane had it this way, a quote she came across, which Diane Norris said, generosity writes you into the story of God. Greed writes you out. See, God is the giver of all good gifts, and God calls us to give because our takeaway, what we remind ourselves every week when we have the giving and the receiving of offering, is that we are never more like God than when we are giving. So my question for you to think about this morning is, what about you? Are you giving to the church what God has asked of you? And if not, why? Are you giving all that you are, not just your finances, but are you giving yourself to the church? Because every one of us has gifts, abilities, resources to give to the church. And we don't just give to the church to be given to the church. We don't just give to the church so the pastor can get a raise, because that ain't why I'm here. If I was here for the money, I wouldn't be here. I'm not being rude. I'm just being real. I'm here because God called me here. And I'm here because I have a message to share for you, and that's Jesus loves you and He wants your life to be different. And He wants all of you, not just part of you. He wants you every day, not just weekend visits. And if we're going to become more and more and more like God, we do that in our giving of ourselves. We are never more like God than when we are giving. And today your challenge is this. If you're not giving, start. It will change your life. I've already shared Miss Jennifer Irwin cannot be with us this morning. So she asked me to share a few things with you that she was going to share, and it will not be as eloquent nor as great as she could, but these are some thoughts that she wanted to share with the church this morning. Jennifer said, give all you can. And she began to unpack that idea of giving all you can this way. She said, what if Marianne Nichols would have said, somebody else go make sure that child's fed on the weekend. I don't have time. Jennifer said, what if Melody Griffin would have said, someone else go clothe the children. I don't have time to take on that. And then Jennifer said, what if I would have said, someone else can worry about school supplies for schools in Abbeville. She went on, she said, you know, we all have something to give. Our time, our gifts, our money. And to give it to God, to family, to church, and to community. Because God has called us to give. So the question for you, for me this morning is, how are we giving? Are we giving how God has called us to give? If you have your Bibles, I would invite you to turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4. We're going to begin in verse 12. This is Matthew's account of Jesus after coming out of the wilderness in temptation. Jesus had been in the wilderness 40 days and 40 nights tempted, yet He did not sin. And Jesus begins His ministry in Galilee. We pick up there in verse 12. Matthew 4, beginning in verse 12. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, He withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made His home in Capernaum by the sea in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali. So that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and for those who sat in the region in shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. And as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And as he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. And Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. There are a few things I want to point out about this passage of Scripture we read. We picked up in verse 12, again, Jesus had just come out of the wilderness and being tempted, and he did not sin, and he begins his ministry in Galilee. And Matthew is intentional in letting us know that what Jesus was doing was fulfilling the words in the prophet Isaiah, that you will go into this land and you will be a great light for those who sit in darkness. And so there's really no doubt that when Jesus began his ministry of teaching and healing and going into the messes of people's life, Jesus became a light in their darkness. So what does that mean for us? What that means for us is that Jesus gave all that he was to the purpose of sharing the light of God in the people's darkness. And again, what does that mean for us? Jesus, if we're going to be followers of Jesus, then that means we need to kind of start resembling and looking more like Jesus. Jesus calls us to also be light in this dark world. And if you go on in the Gospel of Matthew, you will see where Jesus says to his followers, "You are the light of the world," and that "you" is plural. We say that in a nice southern way. Y'all are the light of the world, is what Jesus was saying. You have work to do. And if you will give all that you can, people will see the light of me in this dark world. Again, in your giving, not just your finances, but of yourself, of your time, of your energy, of your effort. How are you giving for the cause of Jesus being made known? And you go on reading in this passage, and you see where Jesus calls to himself followers. He calls to himself disciples. Did you notice how he called them? Jesus, check it out. Jesus called people as they are, from where they are, and being who they are. Did you hear me? Write this down if you're taking notes. Jesus calls people as they are, from where they are, being who they are. So Jesus walked beside the water and he sees these soon-to-be disciples. They're engaged in their everyday jobs. They're earning a living for themselves, earning a living for their families. They're fishing in the Sea of Galilee. Jesus comes to them. He interrupts their normal and typical day and he says, "Hey, guys, follow me." Most likely these fishermen are at the lower end of the socioeconomic ladder. Their work is dirty. Their work is physically challenging. And Jesus says, "Hey, follow me." Their work demands them to be at work from sun up to sundown. And here's what I also noticed about Jesus. Jesus was not concerned that their hands were probably grimy and their fingernails dirty. He wasn't concerned they were wet and they stunk. He wasn't concerned about their lack of social status nor lack of political power. Jesus does not even demand they go clean up and take a shower before they join his mission. Nor does he ask them any questions about their education. Nor does he ask them any questions about their abilities. Nor does he even say, "Hey, are you sure you can take a leave from home for a while?" He didn't say any of that. He says, "Hey, follow me." And they come after him and they follow him. They give all that they can to this man Jesus because they know something special about him. Are you giving all you can to this man Jesus because there's something special about him? He has a mission for you, and the only way this world's going to change is when the church does what the church is called to do and go make disciples. Are you giving all you can to make disciples of Jesus Christ? And did you hear what he says to Simon and to Andrew, or to Peter and to Andrew? Jesus promises them. He promises them something. He says, "Hey guys, I'm going to expand your skills. Right now you're catching fish, but one day you're going to catch people." He comes to the sons of Zebedee, James and John, and they just hear a call. They don't know what's going to follow after this, but they say, "We're going to follow this dude and see what happens." So what about you? Have you made the choice to follow Jesus? Because when you make the choice to follow Jesus, that following will unfold over time. Just like Simon and Andrew, James and John, they didn't understand the full capacity of what it meant to follow Jesus. Following Jesus unfolded over time for them, but they gave all they could. The final thing I think about in these passages of Scripture is that God God's call invites and empowers choices for His followers. Here's what I mean about that. Matthew tells us that Jesus heard about John's arrest, and Jesus withdrew to Galilee. And that's where Jesus called His first disciples. That's where Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount. That's where Jesus began His ministry of healing. That's where Jesus began to teach what it meant for God to be with us. And those first disciples, maybe they would have preferred to keep their regular job, their day job. Maybe they would have preferred to keep things status quo as is, but they decided to follow Jesus. They made that choice. And they saw Jesus and they heard His words. And they said, we're going to follow this guy. We're going to take a risk. We're going to step out in faith. We're going to leave behind that stuff that's comfortable and secure. They chose to follow Jesus and they chose to give all that they could. So my question for us this morning as we close, how is Jesus challenging you? How is Jesus calling you to give more of yourself to Him for the cause of making disciples? For the past few weeks, we've heard the same passage of Scripture read, of where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So we come back to where we began the very first week of this series. What are you treasuring the most? Because that's what you will follow. Are you treasuring Jesus above anything else? Because if you are, then your resources, your time, your energy, your efforts will be all about the sake of Jesus Christ. How you interact in the church, how you give to the church, how you are a part of the church, how you serve in the church will be different when Jesus is your treasure. And as Jennifer pointed out, I mean, it's so easy for so many folks who've taken on ministries to say, well, somebody else can do that. Well, maybe that somebody's you. Maybe God's calling you to give more in the life of the church. So how have the words of Jesus challenged you? How has the love of Jesus changed you? How is Jesus calling you to take a risk, to step out in faith, to leave behind that which is comfortable and secure? How is Jesus calling you to follow and to give all that you can? Because again, it's really all about priorities. If it matters to you, you will make it happen. If it does not matter to you, you will make excuses. In the life of the church, there's a big difference between being compliant and committed. Compliant is enough to just get by. Committed is I will do whatever it takes for the cause of Jesus Christ. Give all you can. Why? Because we're never more like God than when we're giving. How are you giving to the life of this local church? Let us pray. Lord God, following You is not easy. Lord God, following You will bring about obstacles, will bring about negativity, will bring about struggles, will bring about the devil trying to cause problems. But Lord God, let us give all that we can when it comes to following You. We know who wins at the end of the story, and Jesus is You. You've already won. So Lord God, I pray that today things of eternal consequence, things of eternal importance will begin to matter to us so that we will make it happen. And so that we will stop making excuses. And that we will stop being compliant and be completely committed to the cause of Jesus Christ our Lord. In His name we pray. Amen.
You know, I've learned a couple of things. I know I'm 32 years old, but I feel like I've learned a couple of things. And I know I've got a whole lot more to learn as I continue to get older, but one thing I have learned, there's a few things, is one thing is that this world's crazy. As we have seen in the past, you know, past year, this world's crazy, and, you know, there's not a whole lot I have found in this world that I do want to follow other than God, because I don't want to follow the things of this world. craziness. But another thing is that you know, that is hard. It's hard sometimes. It's hard to love. It seems like it's a whole lot harder to love sometimes than it is to dislike or to hate. And but loving feels so much better. And to receive that love feels so much better. And then another thing that I have learned is that one thing that brings me closest to God is to sing and to praise, no matter what the circumstances going on in this world, no matter what craziness is going on in this world, is when I sing, I'm brought closer to God. I'm brought into His presence. And He speaks to me through song, and He speaks to me through worship. And that's what I do. And as Jason says, you know, sometimes we don't have a whole lot to give, and sometimes we may not have the money to give. And I found myself in that situation. We don't always have much to give, but I can always, always give song. He's given me that gift, and so I give Him back each and every week. I give Him back. I give Him that back. That's why I'm up here, is because I can give Him my worship and I can give Him my praise. So I want to ask you, and I want to challenge you now, to do that. Don't just give, you know, half-heartedly. Give your whole heart. Give your whole self. Because sometimes that's all He asks for. He doesn't always ask for all of our money. I mean, He asks for us to give some to Him, but He asks also for us to give ourselves and to give that freely. And I want to challenge y'all to do that now. As we stand and as we sing this song, y'all can stand. It says at the beginning, my foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. And there are so many things in this world that can tear us down. There's many things in my life that will tear me down, but I know I can hold my ground. And I know I can continue worshiping each and every day and each and every week because He gives me so much. And so this is what I give back. So I just hope that y'all can get that back now as we sing.
I lift my eyes up.
time I lift my eyes up.
Church, it's time to leave the building. There's a world who's hurting, a world who needs hope, and a world who needs help, and they need the church to bring it to them. That's our job. We heard this morning that Jesus says we are the light of the world. He calls you just as you are. You don't have to be anything particular because you're already special to Him. And He equips you, empowers you. So go and follow this Jesus, and give all you can for the cause of making followers of Him. Go in the love, the grace, the hope of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us join hands together.